I know as a host, my episodes are supposed to be like children. I am not supposed to have a favorite, but I do. I'm really excited to do this show tonight because I am woman, hear me roar. And I am super excited to discuss women voters this wild and wacky presidential election season, and not just in the soundbite way that usually happens during elections, where we hear one question about soccer moms during debates, and then 20 questions about the size of Donald Trump's hands. We plan on having an in-depth conversation about issues of importance to women that may not be receiving the coverage that they should, but we're probably still gonna miss some things. So if we do, feel free to let us know during the audience Q&A, and please also feel free to tweet us. The hashtag is #politicalparty, and you're actually going to use the handle @thegreenspace, and that's green spelled with an E, and you can also CC at WNYC. But I'm so excited we have a super amazing panel of incredibly smart, incredibly talented, incredibly opinionated women joining us tonight. Basically, Donald Trump's dream interviewers will be here on this stage. So before we cut to our guests, we're gonna go ahead and cut to some video to hear what this year's presidential candidates have had to say about women. You may have heard that a few of them have had some thoughts on us.
Don't you someday want to see a woman president of the United States of America?
I respect women. I love women. I cherish women.
You've called women you don't like fat pigs, dogs, slobs, and disgusting animals. Your Twitter account
only
is
Rosie
several...
O'Donnell.
Real men don't try to bully women.
Every issue is a woman's issue. That's a fact.
Should women who get abortions be punished?
Absolutely not.
We have tried desperately to pass pay equity for women. I will continue that fight.
And the last time I checked, there's no discount for being a woman.
And I have news for the Democratic Party. Women are not a special interest.
Alrighty, so with that, I'd like to welcome our guest who will have some thoughts on those thoughts. First up, Vanessa De Luca, editor-in-chief of Essence Magazine. Liz O'Donnell, author of Mogul, Mom, and Maid, The Balancing Act of the Modern Woman, and founder of the blog WorkingDaughter.com. Emily Shire, the politics editor of Bustle.com, the most widely read online magazine for millennial women. Penny Nance, the president of Concerned Women for America and the author of Feisty and Feminine, A Rallying Cry for Conservative Women. And Michelle Mulligan, the founding editor of Cosmopolitan for Latinas. She is now an editor and community manager at Self Made. Okay, not to toot my show's horn, but I think we have a really great lineup tonight, and I'm super excited and proud of all of them. So I'm gonna own this. Tonight I'm gonna have to eat a slice of humble pie because I spent a lot of this election going on other people's shows and making fun of them for how much they were covering Donald Trump. And now because he actually is a likely nominee, I'm gonna have to spend part of my evening discussing him more than I had planned to or ever thought I would have to. So forgive me, but I'm gonna treat it like ripping off a Band-Aid. Hopefully we'll get a few questions about him out of the way and then we can dive into more important issues. But Penny, I wanted to start with you. It's been an interesting election so far, to say the least. There have been liberal women who have jumped to the defense of Fox News' Megyn Kelly over Donald Trump's treatment of her. There have been conservative women who denounced Donald Trump's comments about punishing women who obtain abortions. So do you think that Donald Trump has actually done the impossible in getting most liberal women and conservative women to agree on something, which is that he's a really scary prospect as president?
The one thing that Donald Trump's been able to do, he's been able to unite conservative and liberal women for about 5 minutes. So, and thank you, Kelly, for having me on. I appreciate it, the token conservative here. But yeah, I mean, really.
It's because you have leather pants.
Yeah, I know. I was trying to up the cool factor for you. No, I think that you're right. I mean, I think a group of conservative women came together early in Iowa and put out, I was part of that, 10 of us put out a letter in Iowa and asked Iowa caucus goers to choose another candidate because we were very concerned about some of the things that you mentioned and also some policy issues as well that most of you would disagree with me on. But, you know, you're right. Hey, he carried New York, so I don't know. I'm thinking in this room there may be some people that perhaps voted for him. I don't know. People are shaking their heads. No, nope.
It was pretty collective.
I voted in Virginia, and it wasn't for him.
Okay. Well, let me ask you this: you and I have both swapped war stories about some of the sexist and misogynist comments that are sort of par for the course in being a woman who appears on television regularly.
Yep. Twitter.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that sexism has reemerged as a defining issue this election cycle, in part because of him and his comments about Megyn Kelly, Carly Fiorina, Hillary Clinton? The list goes on.
You know, it's so funny. If it hasn't, it will, because unfortunately, and I'm a Republican, fucking out myself for that, I think that if he does win the general election, unfortunately, I think the ad has already been cut. And there was one actually cut by a Republican PAC earlier that was simply his own words used again against him. So
his comments about women.
Comments about women. And so, and read by women on screen. It was actually very interesting. You might want to YouTube it. But I think that it's going to be an ongoing conversation and perhaps one that needs to be done. But it's not, it's filtered. It's surprising to me when I do MSNBC, the liberal shows, I get horrific Twitter hate and the C word and other words, you know, that I find shocking and appalling, and all of you do too. And I'm sure you have your stories as well.
Yes. Plenty.
Fox, some point,
MSNBC, any of them really.
But at some point, I think we all have to agree there are words that have to be off limits because they are misogynistic. I mean, the C word should already be out of our vocabulary, just like the N word. I don't understand why that it's somehow still in some quarters acceptable.
But also, but I think the larger thing too that you and I have discussed is that it's not just name calling. I think actually some people have been conditioned to know what not to say to keep themselves from getting fired. Were I to show up at their job and say, this person tweeted this about me, which I've never done. I know some people have actually done that, sent tweets and emails that they've gotten after appearing on air to people's place of employment. But the larger conversation is about how when people disagree, regardless of what side of the aisle they are, one of the first things they do is go after our appearance.
That's true.
I mean, that's like
that's true. The first. But you know, is it Margaret Thatcher that said that she was greatly cheered when someone came a particularly searing ad hominem attack because she knew they'd run out of facts?
Right.
Right. So I don't like it. Of course, it's hurtful. It is hurtful. I'm not going to pretend otherwise. But at the same time, I always realize you didn't say one thing about what I actually said, and so you obviously couldn't counter it.
And Penny, what's interesting too is that what I felt about the Donald Trump coverage is it kind of put a spotlight on what a lot of us who do that kind of stuff had known for years, which is that often happens, that you become a target of your appearance once they stop agreeing with and run out of arguments of other things to say. But we're talking about sexism off the bat, and I actually wanted to kind of get at the heart of the title of tonight's show, which is there a specific policy issue or political issue that across racial or party lines most women agree is the defining issue women should be thinking about when they walk into the voting booth? And I want to just kind of go down the line. Vanessa, can we start with you?
I mean, I don't know that it's necessarily about it being particularly a women's issue per se. I mean, I think it's about quality of life issues, quite honestly, that women care about. So when you think about our audience has told us that they care about the top three things they care about are affordable health care, a living wage, and access to quality education. Now, those things can resonate with across the board. You don't have to be particularly Black, African American to care about those things. They're all important things. I think it's interesting that things are touted as women's issues as if there's something wrong with appealing to what women care about. You know, that's what I find kind of almost disturbing, because we should all care about what women care about, because when women thrive, our whole communities thrive, particularly in the Black community. So,
Liz, do you have any thoughts on a specific issue that you think women across the board are united in believing is of particular importance to us?
Well, I'm going to agree with Carly Fiorina that all issues are women's issues. Mm-hmm. I mean, I always say to women, you know, if you go to the doctor, if you put your kids in school, if you use the roads and the sidewalks, right, you're political. Those are issues that affect all of us. So I don't agree with her on the women's issues, but I agree with her that all issues are women's issues. For me, I was really disappointed in this election so far, and I don't think it'll change in the general, that caregiving, which is viewed as a woman's issue, but is really everybody's issue, hasn't come up. I really thought this would be the year that would hear about caregiving, and we just haven't.
I want to finish, and then I want to go back to that.
Sure.
Emily?
You know, very much in agreement. I think there is no single woman's issue, but especially this election, what I've noticed is that economic issues are increasingly being cast in the light of feminist issues. At least I've noticed that in covering millennials. You know, the Young Invincibles, which is this great research group that focuses on studying millennial views, noted that, you know, among millennial women, abortion and closing the wage gap was in the top five issues, but the top two were general economic inequality and student loan debt. You had student loan debt when more women than men are going to college. You could cast that as a women's issue, mm-hmm. for sure. You can cast raising the minimum wage as a women's issue because more women make up minimum wage jobs. I think it's more that what I've noticed is that there's really a broadening of what could be considered a woman's issue. Mm-hmm. You know, like Liz said, you know, there are all these different aspects, and if you're a woman and participating in this part of life, then of course it can be seen as a woman's issue.
Penny?
Completely agree with all of you. I mean, I think it's silly to pretend that we only care about the issue of abortion. We want to feed our families. We are caretakers of our parents and grandparents sometimes. Women own a third of small businesses. We own all together about 8 million businesses around the country and earn $1.4 trillion from those businesses. And the other issue that didn't come up and after September 11th changed and in the current crisis that we witness on TV every day, security moms are made a resurgence. I was looking at some polling data, and it showed a gender gap that actually women were more concerned about security issues than men. And so I think, you know, constantly hearing about ISIS, what happened in Paris, what happened in San Bernardino is really refocused women on defense issues.
Mm. Michelle?
yeah, I think that as we come into a larger head of our household roles, making these kind of feeling empowered to make these kind of decisions and the things that we can't control. I'm going to actually say the environment is a woman's issue, is everybody's issue. And Mike, in our community, I would say in the last, maybe not in this election cycle, but last year, the environment came up as one of the most important political issues in our community because it was a legacy for our children and our communities mm-hmm. that goes on beyond it. Beyond our lives and beyond even our children's lives. So I think that all of the things that we've talked about in this panel just in the last 3 minutes, we're not hearing in the debates as general issues or as women's issues. And I think that the last thing that I would say is that I am going to stand up and say that reproductive rights are a very important issue for women to stand up for in this election cycle and beyond, because slowly and but surely those rights are being eroded, our access to even our own health care is being eroded. So I think that we need to stand up on those grounds.
It's interesting because I will go ahead and answer my own question. I've been surprised pleasantly, but because I do think it's interesting that we have, you know, the quote, black vote, the Latino vote. No one says like the men's vote or the white vote, right? And people talk about the women's vote, and then hearing on the stage, there's such a host of different perspectives on what that really means. I will say that I believe, particularly the last election reminded us that contraception access is very much still a women's issue, because what they showed time and again is even when it was discussed on television, most of the panels consisted of men who were sitting around providing their, you know, intelligent thoughts about the issue. And I was thinking, that's interesting, because Penny and I were probably both sitting at home and you could have called either one of us to show up. And while abortion remains, at least in terms of polls, a somewhat divisive issue, what we learned last election is contraception access was not. I mean, even among Catholic women. And so I thought, so for me, that's an issue that jumps out, because I believe so many other issues stem from contraception access, economic inequality, you know, people who need resources, and the environment becomes more of a concern, especially when you have kids that you can't afford because you didn't have the access in the first place because your healthcare didn't cover it. So, but it does remind me in terms of talking about reproductive rights, I just saw the powerful new documentary at Tribeca, which is going to air on HBO soon, called Abortion Stories Women Tell. And it was interesting because it profiled women really on both sides of the abortion debate in the state of Missouri, which has some of the most stringent laws next to Texas in terms of access. And so they profiled some of the women activists who helped get those laws passed. And they also profiled some of the medical professionals who were providing abortions, and also some of the women who were seeking them for, you know, a host of reasons. There were medical issues, there was abuse, there were, you know, financial issues. But it reminded me of our friend Todd Akin, who I hadn't thought about in a few years, but he was the senator from Missouri who, I won't say famously, I'll say infamously, said, if it's legitimate rape, the female body has ways to try to shut down the whole thing. That same, apparently he missed eighth grade biology. That same year, Richard Murdoch, a 2012 Senate candidate in Indiana, said something to the effect of pregnancy from rape. He referred to it as something God intended. And so in part because of those comments, I'll be honest, as someone who even covered the election, I had forgotten how much that drove everything in 2012. And so I was wondering, and I wanted to start with you, Penny, do you sense that this election, abortion is just is less of an issue being covered and talked about by the candidates? And if so, why?
Well, now, because they're each talking in their own echo chambers, right? So, you know, the majority of the Republican Party and certainly primary voters are like me, pro-life, and believe that a baby in the womb deserves legal protection. Can I just go back to one thing you said? I want to say there is a divide, though, among women. And you were talking about that. I think you were talking about polling about Catholic women and
contraception.
I think there's a real divide over whether we think, and I'm, by the way, just in full disclosure, I'm an evangelical woman. I only have two kids. I've used birth control, but I also respect the religious freedom of other women. I have Catholic friends who see it differently and don't want to pay for someone else's contraception, right? So the fact, the idea of the Little Sisters of the Poor being forced to pay for Sandra Fluke's birth control, there is a dividing line there. And there is a difference of opinion on that. So I just wanted to be clear on that.
Yes. But the polling I was referring to was the 90% of Catholic women, or is it 96%, who said that they've used birth control?
Yeah, but they, I can, right, yes. That poll is right. Actually
We'll be having this argument over drinks later. Yeah, right. She and I are friends, so yes.
But anyway,
yes.
All my colleagues will yell at me if I don't say this.
Yes. I know.
And then later, like, what do you mean? You just sat there. I'm sorry. Okay. They'll tweet mean words at me.
Okay, yes.
But anyway.
Go ahead, yes. She's in the clear. She's got you guys covered, wherever you're listening. Yes.
Maureen, you heard me.
Okay.
What was your question? Your question was whether or not it will come back up in a general election. Certainly it'll come up. The idea. And I was one of the people that came out and, you know, quoted Frederick and Matthews Green, who said women don't want an abortion like they want an ice cream cone or a Porsche. They want an abortion like an animal whose leg is caught in a trap and they're gnawing it off to resist or to escape. It's an act of violence and sadness. So, I mean,
that was your response to Trump?
Yes, to
yes,
Trump.
Yes. Like, I was trying to clarify for the audience.
What he said. And, yeah. And you know, others, the pro-life community, and that was just him not understanding at all how we think about this issue.
I just want to stop. Everyone knows does everyone know in the audience what Donald Trump said? Okay. I'm getting a yes. Mm-hmm. I think someone probably didn't and feels uncomfortable admitting it. So just in case that person is sitting there with their friend who's like, how could you not know that? I will just say really quickly that he intimated that a woman who gets an abortion should be punished. He was asked, do you believe the woman should face punishment? And he said, yes. And then he surprisingly for him backtracked a few days later. But even more shocking, he didn't think the man should face punishment, which really knocked me over because coming from him, I just expected.
You expected
what? Sarcasm. It was definite sarcasm. It was definite sarcasm. Okay. So then, Emily, what do you make in terms of the audience that you write for? Or is there a sense that reproductive rights is a defining issue this election?
I think it is hugely, hugely important to millennial women to protect reproductive rights. What I would see, and you know, no shocker, millennial skew towards the Democrats. The thing is that when you have two Democratic candidates who both have 100% approval ratings from NARAL, Pro-Choice America, and Planned Parenthood. Yes, both those groups endorsed Hillary Clinton, but the fact of the matter stands is that they pretty much have virtually the same incredibly strong pro-choice records. I am not going to defend by any means that abortion didn't come up as an issue during the Democratic debates until Hillary Clinton made it an issue.
After eight
the
debates.
One in New York.
Eight debates, yeah.
Look, that's bonkers. After eight debates, what I will say is that I understand that for a pure debate perspective, you don't tend to bring up issues where people are in agreement. Mm-hmm. But I think that's incredibly problematic. You know, and I remember speaking to Wendy Davis about this earlier this year, and she felt that younger women, particularly in northeastern states and states that didn't have the restrictive abortion laws that, you know, Texas, Mississippi, Alabama are all facing, is that you're almost too secure. You think it's a foregone protection that, of course, you're always going to have reproductive rights access, and you're not. It's that it's chipping away at the state level. It's a huge problem, and there are creative and, you know, it's sneakier ways with trap laws and things like that that are getting at it. But I think because it's happening more on a state level, we just don't pay attention to it as much. And maybe once the Supreme Court ruling on Texas HB 2 comes out, it'll wake people up. But I think it's not that millennial women aren't caring about it. It's that it's maybe not at the top of their mind the way, you know, the way it should be. Frankly.
I'm going to jump around to a question we actually cut, but I'm putting it back in because of what you just said, which is, Penny, I wanted to ask this. I read a couple of pieces about evangelical reactions to Trump and sort of what he was doing to that community. And I guess part one of that is, have you been disappointed in some of the evangelical male leaders who have come out in support of him? Is that show a bit of a gender divide within that community? But then the second part of that is, one of the articles I read said that some evangelicals have decided that this is kind of the last straw, and they're kind of pulling back from presidential election focus and focusing on state laws and state battles, because that makes more sense. And Emily just kind of touched upon that. So
I think that was already happening. I think that there, and for our organization, we have been active in state legislatures now for 30 years. So that wasn't new for us, but I think there is. I would actually like to say that it's mostly evangelical men that are supporting Trump, but that's actually statistically not true. When I'm looking at the polling data, and even I can even say,
no, I mean the leaders, like some leaders. Of the leadership of the movement. Yeah,
most of the evangelical women leaders really are not supporting him. That's true. And I gotta say, I am disappointed. I do question their judgment. I don't question their motives. But it is such a mess. It's hard to really even get my head around completely at this point. I'll be sorting this out for years.
Well, I did want to go back really quickly, Emily, to something about your audience in particular. I don't know if some of you have heard, but there's a bit of a generational divide among women in the Democratic primary. I'm sure that's breaking news to everyone. But there was an op-ed that I thought took a different angle, because so much of the divide had been portrayed as, you know, women over 50 versus women under 30, and they just aren't on the same page on Hillary versus Bernie. And this op-ed actually argued that there's also a divide between women in their 20s and women in their 30s. And the argument it made in the New York Times was that women, by your 30s, that's when you start first experiencing sexism in the workplace. And it shifts your perspective on, it's not that big of a deal. Have you sensed that at all? Is that something that it's all resonating, or what do you think of that theory?
I think it's really tough, because it also then goes back to, like, what is the fuzzy, you know, delineation of millennial versus non-millennial? And I think it's, I think it's, of course, normal that as you travel along in your professional experience, it's going to affect your political views. Is that the Jill Filipovich piece? She wrote, I believe, something similar to that about the idea of sexism in the workplace will affect your views. I think you could argue the other way, is that when you're in your 20s and you're more likely to be laden with student debt, hearing Bernie Sanders talk about free public college tuition is going to be a lot more appealing. I don't doubt that argument. I just think there are other ways you could counter why Sanders is maybe appealing more to a woman in her 20s versus a woman in her 30s. In the same way, you can argue, you know, that, yeah, Clinton appeals more to a woman in her 30s than a woman in her 20s.
Vanessa, can I ask you, what do you sense is the connection between black women and Hillary Clinton, who I know has been interviewed by Essence more than once? And yes. But I would be remiss in terms of my editors if I didn't plug my own piece about her and black women this week that's on the Daily Beast. But yes. I'm really curious, what is it, do you believe, that's a connection? Because they've really saved her candidacy this time around.
Oh, absolutely, without a doubt. Clearly the Clinton camp understood the power of black women's vote. I mean, it drove the result in the last two elections. And so going into, into this campaign season, it would have been utterly ridiculous for her not to try to appeal to the issues that are of importance to this audience, to talk with the Black Lives Matter movement, to really acknowledge that the black women's vote actually matters. matters. And so I think they've been very strategic and intentional about some of the, even the appearances that she's made. I mean, she's been on Black Girls Rock. She's been, I mean, you know, like places where like, wait a minute, Hillary Clinton, shut up. Like, what's going on here? I mean, I
think. Because when you think Rihanna, you think Hillary Clinton.
Well, absolutely. But I mean, it's very strategic and deliberate, and I think quite smart, because it acknowledges the value of the Black woman's vote, which I don't know that necessarily a lot of other candidates have acknowledged that, that the worth of that vote. She's speaking directly to this audience because she knows if she can really make penetrate and really connect with the audience, that hopefully they'll show up at the polls like they did in 2008 and 2012. I mean, that's
but this time for her.
But not to like, you know, like she's not going to put up, you know, she's not going to let the foot off the pedal. She's going to keep pressing, continue to keep pressing. So I think she has to.
So in the interest of full disclosure, but what my piece is actually about is the fact that if you look at the numbers that you were just speaking of, Black women have consistently saved Democrats in races where they really needed to be saved. Going all the way back to saving essentially President Clinton and his administration during the midterms in 1998 after the Lewinsky scandal, in all the states where Democrats made gains, it was because Black turnout was substantially higher than anyone anticipated, including the Democrats anticipated. And Black women always turn out at substantially higher numbers than Black men. And yet what I was exploring on the piece this week is that you look at how many Democratic politicians, Black women get elected, and yet we've had one Black female U.S. senator. We've had no Black female governors. And so there seems to be a bit of a disconnect, which is one of the things I wanted to explore on our ability to get other people elected in terms of, in comparison
to. Well, that's the other side of the coin. I mean, you think about, I mean, she just came out to say, Hillary just came out to say that 50% of her cabinet will be women. It'll be interesting to see what the makeup of that will be. You know, what the diversity of that 50% will be. And I think it's an important statement to make. I mean, this is an opportunity for her to, if you know, were she to actually achieve the, you know, the presidency, to see how she actually demonstrates. Is this all just kind of talk pie in the sky, or are you really going to put your, you know, really, really put some real meat behind what you're saying? I think that's to be determined.
Well, I guess the obvious follow-up to that is then that there's this new book out that I just started reading called Love Her Not, The Hillary Paradox. Some of you are nodding your heads already. And it's a compilation of essays on women writers and their complicated feelings about Hillary Clinton. And I just wanted to read a brief excerpt of the opening. It says, she's nagging, conniving, and controlling. And don't forget, polarizing. She's fearless, loyal, and intelligent. She's a powerful advocate and a thoughtful friend. She's obsessed with power. And she's a selfless champion for others. When it comes to Hillary Clinton, we just can't seem to make up our minds about whether we admire her for all the things she's accomplished or detest her because she's a woman who's not afraid to admit her own ambitions for political power. Does anyone on this panel want to take a crack at why the feelings about her are just so strong? I mean, to me, that sounds like an essay you write about a best friend that you broke up with.
I mean, we're talking about the double bind, Liz. Right? If a woman comes out as very strong and assertive and open about her ambition, there's a backlash, right? We admire her, we want to be her, but maybe, you know, we look at ourselves and think, why aren't I more like her? I think, you know, the feelings that she brings up are just complicated. You don't want them to be, but until we have more women in these leadership roles, you know, she has to stand for every woman. And so therefore, she brings up a million issues.
Michelle?
Yeah, well, I would say that's true, but it's also not just about ambition, right? It's about her policies as well. It's like if you go through her whole life and body of work, it's like we all don't fall in lockstep and as women behind every decision that was made or every compromise that's been made. So I think that sometimes for a lot of, especially a lot of young feminists, it's been a little condescending to be like, you definitely have to support her. And I'm not representing any opinion of my own. I'm just saying that it's something that I've heard time and time again. There have been a lot of questions and doubts and people have wondered. So I do think that identity politics don't always resonate.
So, but speaking of, since you brought up identity politics, Michelle, but something that you and I have just started discussing, and I think it's a fascinating discussion, is this whole concept of the Latino vote, particularly when you go back and look at the numbers. Right. And actually, particularly for George W. Bush, he got, 30% of the Latino mm-hmm. vote. So I think the idea that Latinos vote in lockstep has been disproven, right? That does not happen. And I guess one of the questions I'd love to ask you, and we just start talking a bit about it in the green room, is on the one hand, there is some power seen in the concept of the black vote, in that when it turned out in mass like it did, there was immense power in 2012 to get one candidate elected because it turned out in one block. But on the other hand, I also think there is something to be said for the fact that both parties court Latino voters because they know that they're up for grabs. And I think that there's an immense power in that too. What are your thoughts on that? And also, I mean, I have to obviously ask your thoughts on what Donald Trump's impact will be on the Latino vote this election cycle.
Right, well, of course. Well, to take the first question, I would say that the Latino community has been really interesting politically because you can't count on the community to go one way or the other based on a party affiliation. The community really looks at the issues and the record of a candidate. And I think that
so for George W. Bush.
Right. I mean, I think that in the case of the support for George W. Bush, that was because he very verbally stated support for immigration reform from an early time, and because he really showed up for the community, what was perceived to show up for the community in many ways. I mean, some of us might argue that was not as genuine as it was portrayed, but it was perceived on the behalf of some Latinos as being in support. And I think that a lot of Latinos really value candidates early on saying, we're here with the community and we're committed to immigration reform and we're committed to issues that matter. And this is what that's specifically going to look like in a plan. Because what often happens is that around an election, everybody shows up and says a lot of things, and those things don't actually happen, right?
And you don't see them for another 4 years or 2 years.
And you don't see them for another 4 years or 2 years. And then also, within at the state level, there's a lot of, I mean, in Arizona and Florida, you have a lot of Latino independents who are really tired of not seeing any action on issues that really matter to our community. So in some cases, people stay home at a rate that they shouldn't. And as far as the Trump effect goes, I don't think it's any shock to anybody here that he's really galvanized a lot of the community to fight back. But I'm not going to just say that it's only about immigration reform. I think it's about discrimination, too. Because one of the things that was really interesting in a poll that was released last week was that immigration was the top issue for Latinos, but the number three issue was discrimination against Latinos. Mm-hmm. So the fact that Trump normalized that and so many people in the outside culture accepted his words. We talked about unacceptable words to use earlier, but there were words that he used that became acceptable about Mexicans being rapists or other things that he said, the journalists just repeated over and over and over again as if there were no consequence. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's something that the community is really responding to.
Did someone want to?
I mean, I just wanted to mention Vanessa. That, you know, there isn't really, the assumption is that, you know, that the black vote is completely democratic and that we're all in. And then we did a study with the Black Women's Roundtable last year that actually indicated that that's not really true, that there's a significant significant amount of black women who aren't really, you know, aligned with either party, with the Democrats or the Republicans, but that they're open to the candidates are actually really going to speak to the issues that matter to them. And I was actually surprised to see that result because, you know, we've heard the myth that's been carried out for decades, for centuries, that this is that the Democrats own the black vote. We're seeing that that's actually not necessarily the case. And I think that we're just looking for a candidate to actually really earn the vote instead of assuming the vote.
And I will out myself as a registered independent. And it was interesting because for my shameless plug alert, for my first book, Party Crashing, the polling that we did back in 2007 found that younger black voters were the fastest growing demographic of registered independents in the country. And then someone you may have heard of by the name of Senator Barack Obama decided to run for president. And there was a bit of a shift in terms of registration. But for me, the question mark has always been what you're talking about, which is what happens to that generation at the end of the Obama era. And I actually think there was a huge opportunity for Republicans, particularly the RNC under Michael Steele. And now we've become the RNC of Donald Trump, which I think is unfortunate, not just for the GOP in our country for a variety of reasons, but it's unfortunate because I do think that there is power in the idea of actually seeing an advertisement during a general election that's targeting me, which I've never seen. I've never seen an ad that is from both parties saying, you know, you, someone who looks like you, Keli Goff, is a swing voter, and I feel it's important to make a, an appeal to you. I don't see that during general elections because that's just not how I'm viewed, and I look forward to the day that it, that happens. But I did want to ask you something, Vanessa, about the research that Essence did on Black women voters when you were talking about the issues that they care about, affordable health care, living wage jobs, and affordable college costs. But among Black women ages 18 to 34, criminal justice reform was named one of the top issues.
Yes.
Why do you think there's a generational split on that?
I mean, I don't know that it's necessarily a split. I think that the older generation cares about those issues as well. I just think that if you think about who's really on the front lines of this new civil rights movement that we're seeing, you think about the Black Lives Matter movement, it is the younger generation. So automatically, it didn't surprise me to see that criminal justice reform or that policing reform would be top of mind and something that they would indicate that they actually cared about hearing from the candidates about.
Liz, so going back to something you referenced earlier, just because I want to have a bigger conversation about this, which is the issue of caregiving. You wrote a wonderful piece for The Atlantic specifically about working daughters and this idea that, so the larger conversation I want to kind of have is, why is it that certain issues become the buzz issues? Like, if I want to appeal to women, I have to talk about reproductive rights, and now maternity leave is in. So I'm going to talk about paid maternity leave because that's like the thing to really get it. And meanwhile, you have the 44 million women you wrote about who include, who are people in my family who are struggling with this, who are working full time and trying to take care of relatives with dementia or with Alzheimer's or with all sorts of host of issues. And that's not talked about when people are saying, let's come up with family leave policies like Twitter got praised for. And really it was a maternity and paternity leave policy. So why do you think it is that certain issues get overlooked?
I think in this case, and there's no caregiver vote, you know, we don't have the caregiver vote that we're going after. In 2012, if you think about Obama and Romney, it felt like every other word out of their mouth was mom. You know, like, I'm President Obama and I love moms, and I'm Mitt Romney and I think moms are the most important thing. And it was just like, mom, mom, mom. I was really hopeful coming into this election that with, you know, our rapidly aging demographic, we've got 10,000 people turning 65 every day. We've got these 44 million people who are providing unpaid care. And the 44 million isn't all women. It's actually a 60-40 split. So it's not a huge gender divide. I just focus on the women because I think they bring a whole host of issues along with their caregiving that need to be addressed. So I think that's the issue. We don't go out and court the caregiver vote. But it's such a missed opportunity in this election, you know, to talk about Social Security and veterans benefits and paid leave, like you were saying. I think as a country, we've started to do a good job of moving from mom issues to parenting issues. Mm-hmm. Right? We don't talk as much about maternity leave. We talk about parenting leave. But we're not talking about caregiving as a whole in general. And that's still to be done.
Well, that's a perfect segue to another question, which is the data shows in terms of the issue of pay equity that actually it may be less of a gender split than a parenting split, because in urban areas, childless women in their 20s out-earn their male counterparts.
Right.
Do you think that perhaps the conversation in the larger conversation elections is going to move away from the idea of just women's issues as opposed to family issues versus those of us who are child-free?
I hope so. I mean, I hope that there, I mean, I don't want to dismiss the very real issues that I think working mothers face in the workforce and that we need to address. But I think the more we talk about family issues, I mean, back to, you were asking earlier about, you know, what's a woman's issue. We look at the wage gap as a woman's issue, but that's really a family issue. Mm-hmm. I wrote an op-ed years ago that said, you know, I get paid on average 77 cents, you know, per dollar compared to a man, and my husband's as mad as hell about it because, you know, it impacts all of, you know, every, well, I'm also the breadwinner in my family, but, you know, we pay for the groceries, and together we take the kids to the doctor, and together we buy, you know, new soccer cleats and pay the mortgage. And so, you know, these are issues that are really family issues, not just women's issues.
Michelle?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that I'm sort of really tired of seeing is that women are not talked about in a very sophisticated way as far as being bread winners and their families. I mean, women of color especially have been branded with, in a certain light, even though we lead the entrepreneurship rate of the country of new businesses. So to me, it's really fascinating to hear. I mean, I'm working with this organization, Self-Made, which is trying to cultivate funding for women entrepreneurs. And looking at all the statistics every day, I'm amazed that about the story of collaboration and sisterhood and earning an agency that we have, and that even that profile is not really addressed as an identity in this election.
Which, in both of you kind of tapped into something that I'm really curious about, you know, looking ahead the next election 4 years or 8 years down the road, which is how women as breadwinners is one of the fastest growing demographics too. How does that shift the conversation, right? When, in terms of talking about economics in this country, pay equity, like how do those presidential elections look like once we potentially surpass men and are the primary breadwinners, whoever wants to jump in?
I mean, I think it speaks to, you know, something I touched upon earlier, that with millennial women, economic issues, whether it's general economic inequality or issues of student debt, are already kind of at the top of their mind. They're dealing with finances right now. You know, I recently read an article where a female feminist Sanders supporter said, you can't focus on, you know, security control of your body until you have financial security. And it's, again, that tie-in. I mean, and so I think we're already seeing, we don't have to wait 4 years to when women are more often the breadwinners than not. I think it's just a realization, and actually perhaps more to people who are, you know, who came of age, who went to college during a recession, that economic concerns sometimes take priority over, you know, reproductive rights and other social concerns when push comes to shove.
Let me ask you another question too. Is some of the data showing that, not some of the data showing, the data shows that single women and women without children are at the highest level they've ever been in America. How do you anticipate that impacting things, Emily? Do you see that having an impact on how we speak politically and how candidates appeal to women?
I mean, I think it'll be interesting. I guess this is when we try, you know, try to look into the future. If women, you know, continue to, you know, and particularly women at the, you know, the top of the highest earning bracket, you know, remain single or not having kids in the same number, you know, then this, you know, mom approach isn't going to work. I think, you know, I personally already find it patronizing. I think my peers, regardless of what side of the aisle they're on, find it patronizing. You know, I remember I even found it annoying, you know, 4 years ago when Michelle Obama described herself as mom in chief at the Democratic National Convention. Michelle Obama is a very accomplished woman. It felt like she was boiling herself down to something specifically to appeal to a very specific perception of female voters. And that rubbed me the wrong way. I think it rubbed a lot of young women the wrong way. That campaign approach isn't going to hold, you know, 4, 8, 12 years from now.
Well, so speaking of Michelle Obama, Vanessa, the Obamas have covered many issues of essence. I think I have them all somewhere stored, special place. But they're extremely popular with your audience. And, you know, I guess what I'm wondering is, what is your sense that the end of the Obama era, how that might impact Black voter engagement?
Well, I mean, part of the whole reason we did this study last year with the Black Women's Roundtable is that we anticipated that there may be people who might not feel that they want to engage because the Obamas are leaving office. You know, I mean, there's been such, I guess, pride and joy about having them in the White House that to we wanted to stem the, and certainly in our study, we asked people, if he were to run again, would you vote for him? And like 88% of people said they would. So clearly, you know, there is an attachment and a real, like, kind of a worry, maybe, perhaps, of what our future will be like. So if you're concerned about whether the next president is going to have policies and continue along with policies that you feel speak specifically to you, then you need to engage. You need to be a part of the, you know, the voting process. You need to make sure that you're not allowing any kind of apathy or stepping back away. I mean, you need to be more engaged than ever in this whole process, because you need to make sure that the next president is actually someone who is going to speak to the issues that you care about.
Yeah, I saw, you know. I saw on Facebook the Obama 2016 bumper sticker, and it's underneath, just to annoy you. I'm pretty sure my mom has that.
That's right.
Before we toss to questions, Penny, I know you identify as conservative, mm-hmm. so I know you have many, many policy differences with Hillary mm-hmm. Clinton, but I know a lot of people who did not vote for President Obama, were not supporters of his, but who took pride in the idea that he was able to get elected, and they mm-hmm. said it made them feel good about our country. Mm-hmm. If Hillary Clinton wins the presidency...
That's, by the way, that's the only thing I felt good about on Election Day. You know, I was sitting with my kids watching when he was sworn in, and I saw these beautiful African-American kids out in the audience, and I was like... I'm so happy for them, you know, it's aspirational, and that was, but, you know, of course, I don't like his policies, so it was a hard day.
So Hillary Clinton is sworn in. Do you have a similar?
Yeah, no, I don't feel happy. No, I don't. I mean, look, I loved what something else Carly Fiorina said, and she said, you know, don't vote for me because I'm a woman, vote for me because you think I'm the most qualified for the job. And I can't be okay with Hillary Clinton's election just because, of course I'm happy that a woman's elected, but I just didn't want it to be her. I wanted it to be a conservative one. I'd way rather it be, of course, Carly Fiorina or someone like her.
Who might be on the VP ticket?
Who very well, not very well might be. I mean, she still could be, even if it's Donald Trump. But anyway... I know.
I'm so glad we're live streaming so everyone could see her facial expression, because yeah. radio but, would not have just caught it.
Yeah, yeah. I guess who won't be included in, you know, the cabinet. No, I can't be. And I, you know, I remember as a teenager and much younger and a little girl being excited about, you know, the first woman president. By the way, do y'all know who Kelly Ayotte is? She's a yes. senator from New Hampshire. She told me the funniest thing, and I hope she doesn't mind me telling this. She said her daughter said to her, she has a daughter who's like, I don't know, maybe middle school or younger, who said, Mommy, are you running for president? And she's like, no. She said, good, because I want to be the first woman president.
Oh, that's great.
They're like, you know, good, right? That she saw that as doable. Possible, and yeah. within her grasp. And it is. It's right there. But I can't be excited about it being a woman whose philosophy and philosophical underpinnings I so disagree with.
But so for the little girl who doesn't have you as a mom, doesn't have Kelly Ayotte as a mm-hmm. mom, who doesn't consider it those types of dreams within reach,
but
you see them?
Maybe I'm naive, but I don't think there's much of that left. I think that most young women do see that as within our grasp. And we've, you know, women are conservative and progressive women are winning congressional seats. Of course, we've got, we don't have even parity, and there's a lot of reasons for that we could over that, you know, drink later talk about. But, and certainly those state races and mayoral races and governors, I mean, we're coming up through the ranks. The progressives, the Democrats got there before we did. But, you know, we have, you know, Joni Ernst and, you know, Kelly Ayotte and Sarah Palin and others, you know, who, you know, that, in fact, when Sarah Palin was chosen, I know a lot of people here probably don't like Sarah Palin, but when Sarah Palin was chosen as the vice presidential running mate for John McCain, I called my then 9-year-old daughter, however, into the room to see it. And it was a good moment because I wanted her to understand that there was, you know, an opportunity for conservative women. And I believe we're, hopefully, if Hillary Clinton doesn't get it this time around, maybe it'll be yes.
Michelle, you look like you have some thoughts.
Oh.
You have as much of a poker face as I do.
Yeah. I think it's an incredibly positive step for women that Hillary Clinton is a candidate. I will say that in the sense that it's a tremendous statement in our nation that we've finally gotten to this point, or maybe the candidate, sorry, I don't mean to jump, is a nominee, I should say at this point. I mean,
Sanders supporters, you can tweet at her. That was Michelle.
She's not the candidate yet, but the fact that she's been so prominent in this election, and the fact that young women get to see somebody like her front and center, and even being a front runner, is I think it does. I mean, whether you agree with her policies or not, I do think it has a positive impact.
Well, to Penny's point, I was just thinking as we were having this exchange that I realized just like there are 10-year-olds who have no recollection of anything besides a black president. Mm-hmm. There are also 10-year-old girls who have no recollection besides Hillary Clinton almost being president or being close to the presidency. And there is something interesting in that.
Secretary of State.
Or Secretary of State, the famous, the Madeleine Albright story. Yeah, there's a famous story Madeleine Albright's told a few times about her granddaughter. Mm-hmm. It was very small, and someone was saying, well, you know, and she was... You know, your grandma's Secretary of State. That's a big deal. And she's like, but all Secretary of States are women.
Because of Condoleezza Rice.
Because Condoleezza Rice.
Right?
Like, she just had no concept.
They always gave it to the woman. Right?
Yeah. So she was just like, okay, that's great. Whatever. You know, which is awesome.
Progress.
I mean, that's great. So yeah. So with that, we'll go ahead and open it up to questions. As a reminder, we're looking for questions, not comments, not quaments. Those are comments disguised as questions, not monologues and not soliloquies. There are microphones on each side. And if you hated something I wrote 5 years ago, this is also not the forum. You can email or tweet me about that. But we'd like to stay on topic for the evening. Not a single question? I'll keep talking, but okay. There are microphones on both sides of the room, so...
Kelly, I hope I'm not putting you on the spot.
Oh, gosh.
But
uh-oh.
When
I'm nervous already.
First, I know. I'm sorry.
Okay.
You were on the Brian Lehrer show maybe 2 months ago in preparation for this series.
Okay.
And I was listening to you describing how inappropriate it was, if I'm remembering correctly, for the Democratic Party to... No, maybe it was more... It was... African-American votes not being monolithic or something about what was happening within your household. And I was listening and listening as I was running around and doing my stuff. And then you said something explaining how the difference between the men and the women maybe in your family were looking at the election. And because it's radio, I had no idea you were African American.
Oh,
so I'm listening and listening. I'm like,
surprise.
Oh. Yeah, I'm like, oh, well, that's right. And I'm just like, oh, it's a young woman. Because it's radio. So I'm like listening. And you said something that was so fantastic about how your family
as a group. I don't know what you're talking about, but your comment's perfect. And you can keep going.
Yeah.
Well, stay up there
as long
as you like.
I feel terrible putting you on the spot, but it was so great what you said about the Bernie effect and the Hillary effect and how nothing should be assumed.
Oh, I actually do know what you're talking about, funnily enough.
You said something so fantastic. It was so great.
Well, thank you. And I appreciate you saying that because there are a lot of people who didn't think what I said was fantastic. And I heard from all of them, and I'm just now hearing from you. So thank you for that. What she's referring to, which actually does fit with this larger conversation, is I wrote a piece about the concept of electability and how people from underrepresented and disenfranchised groups, it was a piece for the Daily Beast titled, I think my editors titled it something like "You're Damn Right Electability Matters to Black Voters or Black Women" or something like that. But it was this larger concept of, I was saying that one of the differences between why black voters and black women were more like, including within my own family, gravitated towards Hillary Clinton, even when they weren't hopelessly in love with her, was because black voters have gotten used to not ever finding candidates we're hopelessly in love with because we don't have the luxury, you know? And so from my parents' viewpoint, in the 1960s, there were candidates who didn't think we were intellectual equals, but they also believed in ending segregation. And if your choice is voting for someone who thinks you're an intellectual equal who can't win, mm-hmm. or voting for someone who says, I don't see you as intellectually equal, but I would love to make sure you're not at the back of the bus, you vote for the person who can get you to the front of the bus. And I was saying how some of that has held. When you look at how African-American voters vote, they don't vote for candidates like Ralph Nader. They're less likely to vote for Bernie Sanders because they want the person that they think can get to the finish line and may not be perfect on every issue, but is good enough on enough issues that they're safe voting for them. And strangely enough, there were a lot of Sanders supporters who apparently did not care for that piece. And I think I heard from all of them, but, or rather my assistant did. I don't read hate mail, so yeah. So thank you for bringing that up.
I love you always, don't write it.
Thank you. And I did not plant her, but I'm so glad you're here.
And I'm here because I thought that was one of the most compelling things I had heard in a long time. In terms of, now that I'm 51, I feel like I am becoming so much more like how my mother was in terms of practical, you know, and there were times when I could have discussions with her and be very high in the sky-ish. And then I remember switching with the Ralph Nader effect and realizing, oh boy.
Well, because one of the things that came up in the piece, specifically in terms of black women too, is this idea that a lot of the Nader voters and Sanders voters are similar in terms of demographic, financially, age, being white, and this idea of how much do you really have at stake if that's your demographic, right? Because the point that I made is, like, I went to NYU, and I was a financial aid kid, and I was very clear, my parents were very clear, that I had a shot, and that was my one shot. So if I got myself in trouble, there was no, oh, it was just pot, mom, because they didn't have $5,000 to bail me out. So that was very clear to me. I had friends from more privileged backgrounds that they could kind of take a chance with life because it's like their parents could kind of fix things for them. And I said, you know, and those are a lot of the people that you see take a chance with their vote because it's just a different calculation. But I appreciate that you appreciated that conversation. We have another question.
Hi, Keli. Hi. As somebody who covered...
Hi, Lynn.
Hi, Keli.
Sorry, it took me a minute. This is Lynn. Okay. This is world-famous journalist Lynn Shire, everyone.
And I thank you for inviting me because there are generational differences, and I really wanted to hear what you guys had to say. But as someone who covered the Ferraro campaign back in 1984, before so many of you were born, it's so embarrassing. those of us who... not only covered it, but cared about women's issues, truly believed that that was the millennium. That, well, there's a female candidate, first major party female candidate for vice president, and win or lose, it was a huge step forward. And here we are in 2016. There's been one candidate who some would argue was or was not qualified, one candidate for vice president besides Geraldine Ferraro. And here we are in 2016, we might or might not have a female candidate for president. My question to you all is, do you see this as the beginning of change or the time of change, or do you think this is a one-time thing and we go right back, just as we did after 1984, to the old way of doing things?
I'm just going to jump in, I guess. I don't think it's just a one-time thing, but I've noticed that among my writers, at least who, you know, like me, are in that millennial age group, they're very suspect of hoping too much. Whether you support Clinton's candidacy or not, they're all feminists and all want to see women in power. And I think regardless of how they feel about her, they're very hesitant to pin too much hope on her possibly getting elected and the sweeping changes. They all will caution it by saying, you know, this is not going to erase, you know, sexism in the workplace. This is not going to erase issues with, you know, wage inequality, which is perhaps more parental inequality. Those are complicated issues that are ingrained. And I think already there's a mindset of, in the best possible worlds, this will be great, but it holds a lot of symbolic value and may not change things on the ground. I mean, you know, getting Clinton elected wouldn't change, you know, the massive disparity in our representation in Congress alone, you know, overnight. I think there is, you know, huge, you know, maybe it's cynical, but concern about how much symbolism will do to improve the everyday lives of women.
But does it, do you believe, any of you, change the possibility for women running in the future?
I don't want to be pessimistic, but I'm worried that if Hillary doesn't get elected, we do slide back. Because I'm, you know, the phrase that runs through my head is, if not her, then who? You know, she's been a senator, she's been in the White House, she's been Secretary of State, she's been working towards this. If she can't get in, who's going to step up and put themselves through that? And who's going to, you know, who are we going to deem is qualified, if not her?
And I'll also add to that, again, plugging my column this week on the Daily Beast, but because it's part of a serious conversation, which is one of the troubling things that's not discussed nearly enough, is the fact that even the women who run and have real shot, either women who run and win or women who run and get close to winning, are still often from political dynasties. Mm-hmm. Even at mm-hmm. the state level, I'm mm-hmm. not just talking about people who, like my great-grandfather was president,
right.
It's that even people running for attorney general, it's well, often...
It's, and it's wives of governors wives. And it's wives of members of Congress and the Senate, absolutely. That, and which is the way women used to get into power.
Used to get into power. Right. And the problem with that is think of the pool we're limiting ourselves to for women who just run. Forget even then getting up to the presidential level, but the women who run. So especially in the age of student loan debt, we're already starting with a pool of people. Who's going to take the risk if they have a choice between working at Facebook or running for city council and they don't come from a political dynasty? I actually think that part of this conversation, which is troubling, is not just that, that we already limit, the process is already limited to people who come from power and money on both genders and both parties. But then on top of that, this idea that in this day and age, I think for a lot of people, it's a big sacrifice to say, I could go work for a tech company, make a lot of money, try to become a female Mark Zuckerberg or Oprah and influence the society that way, or I'm going to go through the slog of knocking on doors at, you know, every weekend to try to run for office. And I think for a lot of millennials, I sense that people say there are different ways to have an impact.
Oh, I mean, absolutely. I can say anecdotally, I have friends who were top in their class at Ivy League schools who didn't want to work on the Hill because, you know, you're going to make 20, 30 grand a year, and they just couldn't, you know, take that over a more
lucrative,
financially solving job, even though they cared about politics and they cared passionately about changing this world. I mean, you know, then other priorities come into play, and I don't fault them for that at all.
But let me say this, and this is one of my pet peeves kind of in this piece, is that if we want to see the next generation, Olin sat down, but if we want to see the next generation, then the Hillary Clintons of the world, the Kelly Ayotts of the world, have a responsibility to serve as sponsors and mentors. Mm-hmm. And I mean sponsors and mentors to people who are not named Chelsea Clinton. And that is not a slam on Chelsea, but that is just to say the fact that people are celebrating the idea that she might run for office. To me, in this country, we shouldn't be celebrating that. What we should be celebrating is Hillary Clinton saying, I'm already working to mentor the 10 black females who worked on my staff for years. They'd make really great candidates. I'm going to give them my Rolodex. I'm going to get Bill Clinton to not just give speeches, but help them on the campaign trail if we want to see the next generation. Because that's part of the problem, is that we don't see enough of that mentoring. And in terms of on both parties, something I've challenged both political parties on is, unless you come from a rich family, you probably can't work on the Hill for $20,000. And if we want to see more diversity in who's working in both parties, right? Well, but I did too. But we're, you know, I don't think we're both
hungry.
20.
Yeah, I was hungry. But can I just, as an encouragement, maybe it's not an encouragement because they're my ilk. I know that there is this bench, though, of women coming up, and they're getting their political chops on city councils and school boards and coming along. So I actually am optimistic. And maybe, I think there is a huge opportunity. There's increased opportunity for women. And, you know, and I come in contact all the time with members of Congress that come from nothing. Mm-hmm. Like Vicki Hartzler from Missouri, who was a teacher. She was actually a home economics teacher, interestingly enough, and decided just to, I don't know, on a whim, run for state rep. And won and was a state rep for a number of years. And then she got elected to Congress. And now she's the subcommittee chairman for the Armed Services Committee. Oh. And nobody messes with her. And she's very bright. And there are those women coming up through the ranks that I get the pleasure and to speak with and to meet. And it makes me hopeful.
Another question?
Hi. Yeah. So this is sort of related to the last question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. So Penny, you had mentioned Carly Fiorina's statement about not voting for her because she's a woman, but voting for her because she's the most qualified candidate. And I hear this a lot sort of as a reason not to vote for women or Hillary Clinton in particular. And I'm just curious on people's thoughts of that, because a lot of different people are qualified for the same job, right? Like on paper, with the exception of Donald Trump, I sort of feel like all the candidates are, like, on paper there's qualified to be president. And I guess my question is, what do you guys think, or you women, mm-hmm. think about voting for the candidate because they're a woman or because they're a diverse candidate? Because lack of representation in politics is really real, and I just see so much reticence, at least in my generation, of people to say, I'm voting for Hillary because she's a woman. And they get accused of reverse sexism and a lot of those kinds of things. So
can I get the first
interested.
One?
Go for it.
I mean, would you also say, though, that they should have voted for John McCain because Sarah Palin was a woman and she's on the ticket, right?
No, I mean, I'm just saying all else being equal. Like if okay, you agree with people's beliefs.
Maybe. I don't know. I mean, I think we make decisions based on all kinds of things. But rarely are there two, especially when you get to general election, there's two candidates that you're going to see. I would argue that we all put our philosophical beliefs first in our voting. And I think that's a good thing. I think we should. And you know, when we talk about we want to elect women, when I'm sitting here, you know, if I'm sitting here and being honest, like, well, no, I don't want to elect all women. I just want to elect women that I philosophically and politically agree with. And you probably truthfully feel the same way, right? You don't want to just, I mean, would you have ever voted for Sarah Palin for president? No, of course not.
It's really funny you bring that up because Gabby Hoffman, who's a, sorry, that doesn't seem to be working, who's, you know, an actress, a millennial, and a huge Bernie supporter, when I spoke to her, gave me that exact example when I said, do you feel a certain feminist obligation? And she said, I didn't to support John McCain and Sarah Palin. And I do think that's the mindset. You brought up a situation where all things being equal, I think that's a tough hypothetical because I don't think anybody who's following politics sees all things as equal. There's some issue they care about enough that there's a difference about that makes it so that it's not all things being equal.
I would vote for, I'm with Gloria Felt, who is a, you know, former head of Planned Parenthood and a women's right activist and author. And she says, you know, until we reach 50-50, then I will always vote for the woman, given the candidates are equally qualified, and as long as that woman supports women's rights. So I probably wouldn't have voted for Sarah, you know, been excited to vote for Sarah Palin for that third factor. But any time that they're both equally qualified, I'm going to go with the woman, because she's qualified and because she's a woman.
So we're going to take one last question before we wrap.
Hi, everyone. So I'm here. I'm a conservative, whereas most women here are liberal. But it's wonderful because they're both women uniting and talking about this subject. If we look at the crowd tonight, we have a difference in like ethnicity, age, but not gender differences in this audience. What I learned from my own job and my own work experience is that my former boss, she took an issue and kept pushing it on her terms to her boss, and her boss wasn't understanding her communication, and therefore she was fired. So using this circumstance and translating into the larger communication, how do we plan to communicate as women to men to have them understand that these issues, regardless of your stance, whether it's reproductive issues, maternity leave, everything like that, they're women's issues, how do we communicate it in a way that shows men that these are issues that they should care about as well? Not just saying, fight, we need this, we need this, we need this, whatever the minority, whether it's women, different ethnicity groups, but how do we show the majority who holds that power that this is a large issue that benefits everyone?
I'm sorry.
Michelle, and then Vanessa. Or Vanessa, then Michelle.
Go ahead. Sorry. No, I mean, the thing that strikes me the most is, do we ever get a platform, I mean, where we're allowed to actually express an opinion? If you look at most of the Sunday morning talk shows, you know, you rarely see, or the morning show, you rarely see women as expressing their expertise.
Right.
So if you don't even get a chance to be at the table to raise these issues to men or to broader audience, then how are we ever going to kind of change the tide of how people think? Because it's as if the women's opinion is not an opinion that should be broadly shared or even considered. And it feels that way sometimes.
Michelle?
Yeah, and I would say that also that you can make a very non-emotional argument, which is that it behooves them economically to support us.
That's right.
We totally are leading the country in innovation both at a corporate and entrepreneurial level. So to bring us to the table benefits men totally.
And they've done the studies that have shown that boards with more women on them are more, the companies are more successful.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's what the studies have shown. But I would also tap into something that Liz has said, because I found this in my own work experience, is that it's not just making the case in the broader context of it benefits men, but like what she was saying about pay equity and her husband. Yeah. I mean, you know, when you can frame something as, this is not a women's issue, I'm not coming to you as a woman, I'm trying to explain something from that benefits this company, benefits this department, benefits what have you, then it stops being a man-woman issue. It starts being a human issue, a community issue, an employee issue, which I guess is what this entire conversation was really about. That what was it that Hillary Clinton said in Beijing, that human rights, women's rights are human rights. Everyone knows it. So I want to thank our guests, Vanessa De Luca, Emily Shire, Liz O'Donnell, Penny Nance, Michelle Mulligan. Thank you so much for taking time to join us. I want to thank our team here at WNYC, Jennifer Sindro, Blakeney Schick, and Ellen Rolfes. And I'd like to close with one final question for our guest. If we could just go down the line here, I'll start with Michelle. If our country does elect its first female president this year, what is different the day after the election?
Oh, gosh. Well, I mean, I do think that we do enter an era in which we're recognized to be global leadership is recognized in a different way.
Penny?
It's hard for me to separate the gender from the policies, but I would say, again, it is encouraging for, you know, our children, our girls to see that opportunity laid out bare in front of them. And that is that there's something good about that.
Emily?
I like to think women would be only more inspired to run then, and that it wouldn't be by any means a derailing factor in female political ambition.
I'll add to what Penny said. My daughter will see that a woman can be president, but so will my son, and I think that's really important too.
I think it's hey, welcome to the club, America, because there are so many other countries that have women leaders.
Perfect note to end on. Thanks so much to our panelists again. And thanks so much to all of you for coming out tonight. Here's Penny's book. Have a good night. Thank you.